97. Going to do all three verses.
Where the Savior shall soon be. Say to someone who feels like they've lost it all, over the edge with no one there to break their fall. And what do you say to someone who feels so unloved, giving themselves away a little bit every day just to be good enough? What do you say to a hopeless soul who can't remember their way home and everything is out of their control? There is no valley, there is no darkness, there is no sorrow greater than the grace of Jesus. There is no moment, there is no distance, there is no heartbreak He can't take you through. So before you think that you're too lost to save, remember there is nothing greater than grace. What do you say to someone whose life is on the line and they're unsure what happens after their last breath? And what do you say to someone who's only known abuse, when the walls they've built to save themselves makes it hard to hear the truth? And what do you say to a life of regret that's trying so hard to forget? And what do you say to dreams unmet? There is no valley, there is no darkness, there is no sorrow greater than the grace of Jesus. There is no moment, there is no distance, there is no heartbreak He can't take you through. So before you think that you're too lost to save, remember there is nothing greater than grace. So don't lose heart, don't let go, and don't give up. You are not alone. There is no valley, there is no darkness, there is no sorrow greater than the grace of Jesus. Oh, there is no moment, there is no distance, there is no heartbreak He can't take you through. So before you think that you're too lost to save, remember there is nothing greater than grace. There is nothing greater than grace. nothing greater than grace. Before I sing this song, I just wanted to thank the Lord for everything He's done for me, and I wanted to thank this church. A lot of you don't know who I am, but 11 years ago, this church took in my family for a few months before we moved back to North Carolina, and y'all just been a huge blessing to me, and I have really good memories here. I just want to give God the glory for everything He's done. To find the power and comfort of God's hand in mine. Season by season, I watch Him amazed in all of the mystery of His perfect ways. All I have need of, His hand will provide. He's always been faithful to me. I can't remember a trial or a pain He did not recycle to bring me gain. I can't remember one single regret in serving God only and trusting His hand. All I have need of, His hand will provide. He's always been faithful to me. Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. All Thy hand needed, Thy hand hath provided. Lord, unto Thee. This is my anthem, this is my song, the theme of the stories I've heard for so long. God has been faithful, He will be again. His loving compassion, it knows no end. All I have need of, His hand will provide. He's always been faithful. God's always been faithful. He's always been faithful to me.
on America's cure for emptiness. America's cure for its emptiness. America has been empty spiritually for a while. A lot of Christians are empty spiritually. We've gone through a year and a half of struggles with COVID viruses, financial downturns, people not being able to work, missionaries not being able to be on the field. And got a prayer letter from our missionary to India, Brother Gordon, and they've shut them out again, probably until October. And they're expecting that next wave to come through, and they have to go in on a tourist visa. They don't allow missionaries, and so there are no tourists allowed to go in under any circumstances, and things have gone on. It's been a rough year and a half or so for the world, and much of the world was already empty spiritually, and they've kind of lost their sense of direction. There are a few that have found the wrong sense of direction. They have found false religions. They have found riots and all kind of other things to make their lives full, not feel so empty, feel like they're accomplishing something. Thank the Lord that many have found good things. Now, sad to say, some have not found godly things, but as far as salvation and those things. But many have found good things, and they have helped hundreds and thousands upon thousands of people by their own efforts, by their own labors, put together things to help folk. Our missionary in goes to Cuba. He's not in Cuba, but Brother Henry Binnock. Well, Brother Henry said this is the first time they've ever done this, but they've not been able to go into Cuba, and so they have given out food baskets. Said they've never done this before, and I've known Henry for a long time, and he's not a big promoter as far as things like that. And deals with Jewish people mostly. In Cuba, he deals with both. But they've given out beans and rice and things of that nature to the Jewish people they deal with on a regular basis down there. And said it has opened doors for the preachers that are in Cuba to be able to witness to these Jewish people. And they even tells in the letter that one Jewish person said that Jesus Christ is the most important person to ever live. I don't think that Jewish person has gotten saved, but at least they see that and the change that comes into the lives of people who have Jesus as their Savior. And there are people doing things. Well, unfortunately, Christians get empty every now and then. Most of us don't have a very long ability to put up with things. We like to get things done, get them done now. And when things drag on, most of us get that empty feeling. Well, we can't do anything. We're not able to do what we want to do. And yet, the Lord is still the same Lord. God's still the same God. But America, I believe, has turned even worse than I thought America would. I was praying for revival during this time, and there have been pockets of revival. There have been people saved, but all of this has caused people to feel empty. And Hosea chapter number 10, verse number 1, the Bible says, Israel is an empty vine. Hosea 10 and verse number 1, Israel is an empty vine. I'm not going to give you the rest of that right now, but Israel, God calls them an empty vine at that particular time in their history, and they're an empty vine right now. We pray for Israel. There's a lot going on. We did get up again this morning about 3:30, and so at 4:30 I was watching the Jerusalem Dateline, and boy, they a lot of stuff that's going on in Jerusalem over there right now. A lot of problems over there, and the rest, a lot of the rest of the world is still against them. But they're talking about, I will mention this, they've been talking about the peace accords that President Trump had been able to get started, and now they're talking about the Cyrus Accords. And they said this, that Cyrus, the reason they're talking about it, was that Cyrus is the king who let them rebuild their temple. And boy, the Jewish people are excited about the ones who are religious, the ones who are looking for their Messiah. They're excited about the Cyrus Accords, to where they might be able to rebuild their temple. And when just one short segment said about it. But there's a lot going on over there. But they have problems. It seems like the world is against them. And hopefully and prayerfully, our nation will not turn against them. And hopefully and prayerfully, our nation will not turn our back on them. To turn against them is one thing, but just to ignore them is another thing. We need to continue to support the nation of Israel. But Israel here is an empty vine. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, we ask your blessing on your word. Pray that your will be accomplished in our lives. And Lord, those empty places in our hearts. And Lord, we know from time to time there's always an empty place that shows up. Lord, we're not empty everywhere and all the time. But Lord, I pray that you'd fill those empty places today. We'll thank you and we'll praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to read out of the Psalms, Psalm chapter 69. I want to read five or six verses. And about a time when David felt empty. I'm not going to take time to give you the background of the whole chapter. I just want to read this verse, start in verse 14, read through verse 20, where the Bible says, "Deliver me out of the mire. Let me not sink. Let me be delivered from them that hate me out of the deep waters." Now, here's a fellow that felt alone and felt empty, felt like he wasn't having the presence of God and everything. That's Psalm 69, verse 14. Verse 15, "Let not the water flood overflow me, neither let the deep swallow me up, lest and let not the pit shut her mouth upon me. Hear me, O Lord, for thy loving kindness is good." I want to say that the psalmist wasn't asking on his own goodness, but he's asking God for these things out of God's loving kindness, God's grace, God's mercy, his hand of love, his faithfulness to us. "Thy loving kindness is good. Turn unto me according to the multitude of thy tender mercies." Now you remember, mercies is you not getting what you do deserve. And the psalmist tells us in several places that his own iniquities had overwhelmed him. And so he's asking for mercy. "Lord, I know I deserve everything I get." I'm talking about in the bad way, is what David is saying. He said, "But let your mercy please rule in this case. And in the multitude of your tender mercies, and hide not thy face from thy servant, for I am in trouble. Hear me speedily." I don't know how many times you've ever prayed and said, "Lord, help me quick. I'm in trouble. I need it now." And of course, God doesn't always help us now, because we think we need it now, but sometimes God has to let us stew a little bit. Especially if it's something we've done. He has to sometimes let us just simmer a little bit or stew a little bit so that we can come to the place where we don't do that same thing again. And parents, that's why you don't always pull your kids out of every problem they get into, especially immediately, because they think they can get by with it after a while. They've got to pay a price, and we do spiritually as well. But he says, speedily. And then verse 11, "Draw nigh unto my soul and redeem it. Deliver me because of mine enemies." He's praying that God would work on him on the inside. He's empty on the inside because of all of the things going on. His enemies, his own problems, his own sins, everything else that's coming into his life. He says, "Draw nigh." Verse 19, "Thou hast known my reproach and my shame and my dishonor. Mine adversaries are all before thee, He's reminding God that God knows what's going on. And he said, you've known all of these things about me, about his shame. And boy, that shame, you may be shamed by somebody else, but that should not bother you if you've got no reason to be ashamed. You just have enemies. And if you've got reason to be ashamed, then confess it and get it right before God. Verse 20, reproach hath broken mine heart. Now here's a fellow that needs help. Reproach has broken my heart, and I'm full of heaviness, and look for some to take pity. But there was none, and for comforters, but I found none. The psalmist is saying, I was looking for somebody to take pity on me. I can imagine as David looked around, and one of his counselors, he looked at him, and he said, I don't feel sorry for you. You brought it on yourself. You got to learn, David. Don't do that again. I can see as he looked around, maybe said something to a wife, and she said, well, what do you want me to do, David? You know, you brought this on. David talks about his own iniquities a lot of times. Now, he had enemies that just hated God, and that they were his enemy because of God. But nobody could come in and take care of David's needs except God. And I'll tell you, we're at that place in America, and it's always that way. Nobody can take care of America's needs except God. And nobody can take care of your emptiness except God. All the people that help you during your struggles, during your times. I tell you, my sister, I talked with one of my sisters yesterday. She called to let me know that my oldest sister, who's broke her leg, that she has bone cancer, but it's the good type. You know, thank the Lord for a good type of bone cancer. It's the easiest cured if it can be cured. So anyway, but we was talking for a little bit, and we was talking about my sister lived way out in the country, and the only really people that live close are her son and daughter-in-law. The other son and daughter-in-law live way further away, and there's not a lot of other people live back in that part of the woods, but people have been coming by and helping and meeting their needs. I said, and they do, and we thank the Lord for that. But I said, the greatest need is for God to come by and for us to recognize him when he comes by and not to turn him away and say, I've got this, God, but to give our hearts and lives to him. Let me read just a few things that I've written down. Problem with America today is we're empty of God and we're overwhelmed with all the things that go on, hurt, pain, and everything else. We're empty of God, but we are full of self and selfishness and trying to work our own way out of the problems. The problems in America, number one, are pulpit problems. Preachers are not preaching the Word of God. They're preaching social issues. Now, I'm preaching the Scripture this morning, even though it's a social issue as well. But the world in America, churches have gone social. They want to preach about how we ought to love and agree with the homosexuals and those who don't know whether they're boys or girls and whether they ought to change themselves from one to the other. And I'm telling you, that's a terrible thing to do. You shouldn't do it. And I know there are preachers who are not talking about this anymore because if they go on the internet, they're afraid the government will close them down, take them off the internet, and they might. They might do so. Facebook might do so, and others may do so. But sin is still sin. It doesn't matter what it is. America turning her back on God is sin. And it doesn't matter if it's the president, the vice president, secretary of state, whoever they've got, whether it's our governor or somebody local or the preacher that's not doing his job preaching. It's empty pulpits. Don't have men of God preaching the truth of God. And the job of the preacher is to preach the Bible, what the Bible says. And sometimes it is about issues. The Bible says faith come by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. So it's the Word of God that's got to be preached. The Apostle Paul told them he didn't come with enticing words. It wasn't his great education that did the job. It's the Word of God that works in the hearts and lives of people. But it's not just empty pulpits, it's empty worshipers. Empty worshipers. Worship services that are not worship services. A while back, Brother Murphy mentioned the fact that there are people who are in charge of the smoke during worship services so they can put some smoke out into the air so that it looks like smoke. I'm sure it's not anything hazardous to anybody, with vapor, whatever, steam, whatever it is, because they act like the power of God's moving in on them. All that is entertainment. That's not the Word of God. There's nowhere where it teaches us to do that. And we have to be careful that we don't go off into those kind of things. Now, am I against those people? Not against those people at all. But that's not true worship. I know churches that if you don't stand and wave your hands, they don't think you're right with God. I know a Baptist church in Alabama that everybody in their church during their Sunday night service gets up and walks around and says praise God and hallelujah, and they do all of that for about 30 minutes. And I know one time my oldest son went to that particular church, and he just sat back and was watching. And so the preacher got down and said, everybody that's saved is already up and serving the Lord and worshiping God. All the lost people still sitting. And Scott said he looked around, he was the only one still sitting. So he had to be the lost person in the church. Because that's the way they believe. That's, you got to show that, you know, you're a child of God by doing all of those things. And we have to be careful that we don't reach out for gimmicks and other things to get the heart of people, because it's the Word of God that gets the heart of people. And we need to learn how to worship God and serve Him in a right way. It's empty lives that are the problem today. And James 2 and 20, Bible says, but without know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. The word vain means empty. It means of no benefit, of no help to anyone. And that's what's a lot of people's problem, is they have an empty life. They have a faith that doesn't produce anything, which is not Bible salvation. Empty religion. James 1 and verse 26 says, if any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. It's empty. A lot of empty religion today. A lot of religion is only about helping other people. It's only about accepting the world's new sin and those people. It's about helping them to feel good about themselves. Some of you maybe were, well, all of you that's my age anyway, if you took psychology in high school or in college, you read in there that it was an aberration. I don't know if that's the exact word. I can't pronounce it correctly this morning. That it wasn't homosexuality wasn't normal, and all of those things. Well, about 10, 15, 20 years later, in the psychology books, it says we have to accept it so that these people do not have psychological problems. They're having a hard time accepting themselves. So we got to get everybody to accept it. And so that's even in the medical books and everything else now. They want to change, but God hasn't changed. And they have empty religion, empty lives, and then they have empty Bible studies. There's a lot of Bible studies that aren't worth the electricity it takes to turn the lights on. And the reason it is because they get together and talk about foolish things. Titus 3 and verse 9 says, avoid foolish questions and genealogies and contentions and striving about the law, for they are unprofitable and vain. In other words, empty. They want to know about aliens. They want to know about all kind of other things. Just teach what the Bible says and leave it at that. One of the things about Israel, and it wasn't on the Dateline program, but another program that I watched about the importance of Israel, they were going back to their genealogies, and some of the Arabic people said if they can just trace their genealogy back to a certain group, and that's the group that was in Jerusalem before Israel came into the land, if they can trace their genealogy back, they can prove that land is theirs. And so they're going to talk about their genealogies and all these other things. God gave it to Israel. I mean, that's a good enough bill of sale for me. And they'd better leave it alone because he's going to protect them. It looks like all of those from the north are getting their hooks ready, fixing to come into Israel. I don't know if the rapture will happen this year, next year, the year after. I don't know. But it looks like everything is set up. And they want to argue about whether Israel ought to be in the land or not. We've got to leave those things alone. Back to the book of Hosea. We'll get to the message very quickly this morning. I want to give you all of that just simply by way of introduction and getting the stage set. America and the world and every individual, there's an answer for the emptiness in your heart. Now, first of all, in Hosea chapter 10, I want to start in verse number 1 and show their condition. And then we'll get to the cure. In chapter number 1 and verse number 1, the scripture says, Israel is an empty vine. Their condition is emptiness. They don't know that they're empty. The college professor that says abortion is okay, he's empty, spiritually empty. He doesn't know it. The ones that teach evolution, they're empty. I remember a lot of years back, 1981, I believe. So a few years back, when a college professor in Hammond, Louisiana, put an article in the newspaper, paid for it himself, that the theory of evolution is now a proven fact. And that was big, bold letters. He paid a bunch to get it in, I'm sure, and then had a small column. So I called and asked him if he was taking questions about it. And he said, there are no questions. I said, you are an English teacher. You're not a scientist. You call the theory a proven fact. It's not a theory if it's a proven fact. And do you know what it takes to be a proven fact? And I gave him the three things that were necessary. I said, and that can't take place. So it's not a proven fact. He said, well, the volume of evidence. I said, there is no chain of evidence. There is no truth. And I began to go down the line and he began to tell me, I said, you're going against every scientific fact by saying what you're saying. And of course he said, well, you're not as educated as I am, therefore you don't know. That's the big answer for it. They're empty and they have no idea. So they swallow anything that comes along. They act on feelings and they try to satisfy self and lust of the flesh. They bring forth fruit to themselves. And these leaders, they are empty vines that have nothing to give to anyone else. Isaiah 29 and verse 8, I believe I have written here. It shall be even as when an hungry man dreameth, and behold, he eateth, but he awaketh, and his soul is empty. You see, they're just like a hungry man. He's asleep, and he dreams of a big steak. We was talking about them Wagyu cows earlier. He eats one of them big Wagyu steak meals. Baked potato, salad, whatever you want on yours. I mean, it was made all the way the best you could ever get. But he wakes up and he's still empty. Or as when a thirsty man dreameth, and behold, he drinketh, but he awaketh, and behold, he is faint. And his soul hath appetite, so shall the multitude of the nations be that fight against Mount Zion. When you're empty, you're empty. You can dream that you're all right, but you're not all right. If you're not saved, you can dream you're all right, but you're not all right. You need to be truly born again. To ease the emptiness, in Hosea 8 and verse 11, and I'm not going to turn, but they build altars to false idols to fill their emptiness. You know, over the years, I've had lots of people come here, other churches that I've pastored. We've talked about church membership. And some have said, well, I'll come in and we'll change things. I said, no, you won't come in. If you come into our church, you come to join us, not to change us. We're not here to have people to come to tell us we're doing everything wrong. We're here to do what we believe is right, and you're not going to change us. Yeah, but But you know, you can get more people if you do this. And I remember one in particular. He said, if we would just put black lights and strobe lights in, we could get all the young people in. I said, what are we going to give them with that? They're going to think that's what it's all about. That's not what it's all about. It's amazing. Now, I'm not against all special effects, by the way. I remember a few years back when our young people did sign language with the black lights and with the white gloves. Man, that was beautiful. And I think it's great to have those kind of things. But that's not the main thing. The main thing is giving the Word of God. They had a divided heart. Hosea 10, verse number 2, their heart is divided. You see, the problem with America and with many Christians, the reason they're empty is they've got a divided heart. They're trying to serve two masters, and the Bible says we can't serve two masters. It's like these fellows that go to Congress, the House of Representatives, the Senate, whatever. They get up there and they say, oh, I'm a Christian, but I got to put my Christianity over here when I come in to talk about all these things, and I can't vote according to my Christianity. Well, the early leaders of this country didn't believe that. They're divided hearts. And they try to fill both their own gratifications and serve God, and you can't serve God and mammon, the Scripture says at the same time. They rejected a king, chapter 10, verse number 3. For now they shall say, we have no king, because we fear not the Lord. What then shall a king do to us? We don't have a king. We don't fear God. And God's not our king. You see, they don't want any authority over them. This group, Antifa, whatever their name is, they don't want any authority over them. Most of the left-leaning, far-left liberals, they don't want any authority over them at all. And those who are socialists, they want to be the authority, and they want to rule over you. Here they don't want a king. They've rejected the King of Kings. The Bible tells us in John chapter number 8 that they do not know who their master is. They don't know that they're the servant. Well, then they've broken their covenant with God. Hosea 10 and verse number 4 said, they have spoken words swearing falsely in the making a covenant. This judgment springeth up as hemlock, it's poison, in the furrows of the field. You see, they're not even honest. They say they're going to make a covenant with God or with somebody else. They don't even intend to keep that covenant. Let me tell you something. You come down this aisle weeping and saying you want to get saved, you don't want to die and go to hell, but you don't give God your heart, you're not serious, you're still going to die and go to hell because that's not real. You can't fool God. Give him your heart. Give him your life. So they have the broken covenant. And then in verse number 5, the glory of God departs. And I think this is where America is now. The inhabitants of, Samaria shall fear because of the calves of Beth-Aven, for the calves of Beth-Aven, for the people thereof shall mourn over it, and the priests thereof shall rejoice on it for the glory thereof, because it is departed from it. The calves of Beth-Aven were the calves that they worshipped and even sometimes offered infants to, sacrifices. And they can't figure why God doesn't help them anymore. The glory of God is gone. And they don't even realize it. The glory is departed. And then the sixth thing in verse number 6, the sense of shame that finally comes upon them. And it shall be also carried unto Assyria for a present to King Jareb. Ephraim shall be received shame, and Israel shall be ashamed of his own counsel. America doesn't feel shame, but America has been shamed. Many Christians don't feel shamed when they do wrong, but they ought to. You see, that's their condition. It's their condition because they've turned their back on God. It's their condition because they're empty of God and full of everything else that has come in. And they just keep changing and keep going and trying to find something else that'll make them feel better. But you can't keep them because they are not God's children. They've never been truly born again. What's the cure? Look at verse 12 and we'll be finished. Sow to yourself in righteousness, reap in mercy, break up the fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till He come and rain righteousness on you. The two things that are mentioned there, actually three, is one is to sow in righteousness. This thing of sowing in righteousness, and then it says until He come, is the farmers, as all the farmers know, and everybody that's had a little garden, it takes a while when you sow. You don't sow it today and tomorrow it comes up. I know I've told this story one time. There was an Italian fellow in Hammond, and in Hammond, Louisiana, there was a lot of Italians, a lot of Sicilians, different groups there. But this guy happened to be Italian, and he liked to pull jokes on people. His daughter rode our church bus. And one day I was out there inviting him to come, because the daughter wanted him to come, and he was telling me he just didn't have time, he couldn't do it, and one of his buddies come up. Of course, they began to talk to each other and louder and different things, and finally he said, "I'll bet you $100." And his buddy says, "I'll bet you $100. He said, "Here's what we're going to do, preacher. Can you come by tomorrow afternoon?" I said, "I can." But Wise said, "I bet him $100 that tomorrow I'm going to have strawberry plants growing, watermelon plants growing." I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He said, "I've got them in the oven right now. I've got the pilot on the gas oven. And I've got those things. All I got to do is put them in and water them, and tomorrow they'll be out of the ground that tall." I said, "I'm not getting in on your bet." He said, "I want you just to come and show him that it's real." I said, "I'm not getting in on all this." He said, "I'll give you the $100, give the church the $100. I said, "I'm not getting in on all this." I went by the next day, Sunday after church. This was on a Saturday. I went by, and he had already gone out there. He went to the feed store the day before and got a bunch of watermelon plants that was about that tall. And he went out and pulled his seed out and put them watermelon plants in. The other fellow showed up and he said, "I can't believe it. You got magic seed. I don't know how in the world you did that." Of course, he had told me, he said, "Don't you tell him the truth now, preacher. Don't you tell him the truth." I said, "Only if you promise to come to church tonight." He said, "I'll come to church tonight. Just don't tell him the truth." And I didn't tell him the truth, and he came to church. He didn't get saved, but he came. So in righteousness, it takes a while. You don't just put the seed out there and it grow. You don't just pray and it happen immediately. Not every time, sometimes. But instead of sowing to ourselves, we sow to righteousness. And let God do the blessing. Then he says to break up the fallow ground. That fallow ground is that hard ground. I've said this. In fact, I preached on this just a few months back. But that fallow ground is what we used to call the headland. My grandfather had a steel-wheeled tractor. Had them cleats on it. We had to crank it by hand every time, all that kind of stuff. And when we'd plow, get to the end, because he would turn on that end down there, and that ground with them steel wheels didn't have anything dragging it up, loosening it, it would just get hard, hard, hard. It just wouldn't grow anything. It wasn't fit to grow anything. Well, it's not just the headland, it's our hearts. You can't let it get hard. You've got to keep it turned up. You do that by studying the Word of God, by prayer. You do that by being in the Lord's house. You do that by doing the work of God. You see, as you do the work of God, God keeps your heart fresh. It's hard to be mad at somebody when you pray for them, isn't it? It's hard to say something against them when you're praying for them and when you're working with them and trying to help them. Break up the fallow ground and then seek the Lord till He come, until He rain righteousness upon us. You see, again, it's not happening immediately. That emptiness can be gone. It could be gone for America. It could be gone for our state. It could be gone for other states. It could be gone for Christians. All we have to do is see the signs and follow His directions. Let's bow our heads for prayer.